I've seen fire and I've seen rain. I've seen sunny days, the thought would never end. Seen lonely times where I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. Look down on me, Jesus. Gotta help me make a stand. 'Cause I won't make it through any other way. I've seen fire and I've seen. In sunny days, the thought would never end. Seen lonely times where I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. How are you guys doing? You guys just jinxed each other. It's the dawn of the final day. Can't complain. Good for you, Chen. I can't tell if I'm ready for the semester to be over or if it still feels like it's been on pause since break. Yeah, the whole thing feels weird. It doesn't feel the same. Everything's kind of like blurred together with the quarantine. Yeah, Max Bowersox made this. That's right, Max. Well done, man. Did your guitar strings arrive? Rabbits never die. That's the title track. Thanks to difference equations, they never do. My goodness, Jonathan, the last class of undergrad. Is that the same for the rest of you as well? And who'd have thought it'd be streamed online? Not ready for industry or research. I still stink at this. Don't worry, we all feel the same way when we graduate. I still feel the same way as a professor. You just fake it till you make it, Falcon. Took you 4 years to find out that you love controls. Hey. Good for you. There you go, fake it till you become it. can tell you, you don't stink. Okay. Are you guys ready to make a flow chart? I hope you are. I think it's always fun to put together like a little flowchart, a network that connects a bunch of concepts. I think you'll see we covered quite a bit. You guys have your paintbrushes ready? Okay. We should use some flowy title script. Your finger painting? Yes! Flowchart. You have your Bob Ross wig prepped and ready? Good. How do you guys feel about that title? Okay. Let's start with a little drawing. We got a motor with a wheel. Okay. So let's say we're controlling a motor with like a wheel attached. So first thing you need to do when you're controlling something is define what you can measure as your output and what you can supply as a control input. I think that's the first thing you should do after you identify what you want to control. So output what I can measure. And then you define your input. This is how I can affect, and I think I'm using the right version of affect here. Okay. And then, so you have a physical system, you define output and input, and that gives you some idea of where you're going to start. From here, you should also have some idea in mind of performance. So performance is all about the goal of control. I have some idea already in advance of how I want this system to behave. So there's two types of performance characteristics: transient, and there's also steady state. So for transient, let's just list it. These are the ones I always use. You might have a settling time, and you have a range, like a minimum and maximum that you're expecting. Same thing with rise time. It has to rise faster than some limit, but you might also specify an upper bound. And I also use overshoot. Usually there's just some maximum overshoot that you specify. Okay. And then steady state. This is when you're, I'm going to give a step reference, I'm going to give a ramp reference. You're going to specify steady state errors in terms of KP and KV, because that's just a concise way of doing it. So usually, almost always, you're going to have KP should be infinite. And then KV, usually that's not going to be infinite in a lot of cases, but it's going to be greater than some minimum KV. Because the bigger you make KV, the less steady state error for a ramp you have. Like, I think for project one, a lot of you had KVs of like a 5 or a 6 or a 7. But the bigger that number gets, less steady state error you have. Okay, now, so you have some performance that you want to get, but you also have some constraints. Let's talk about some constraints you might have. So I'm going to come over to this left-hand side and I'm going to draw an Arduino. It's got some pins on it, some like microchips. But it could be any type of microcontroller, right? And one of the constraints you're going to deal with is that your sampling frequency has to be less than, let's call it like some maximum sampling frequency that you can get out of that device. So I've been playing a lot with, your standard Arduino Mega, and I'm finding if you're doing an application like that, you might want to somewhere between 20 and 100 hertz is probably what you're working with. And from here, whatever you pick, you can define your sampling period, 1 over FS. But this is one of your constraints when you're designing a digital controller. Usually you'd like to sample as fast as you can, get a lot of information, but in real life, we have some limitations, so that's one of them. Another one is, so let's talk about the motor. You have voltage, and that voltage is being supplied by a power supply. So the power supply will have limitations. The motor itself has some voltage limitations. So another constraint is usually the magnitude of your input has to be less than some maximum. So like project one, that was 6 volts. Okay, so this is the first thing you do when you want to control something. You identify, what can I measure coming off of this? What can I supply as an input that'll actually affect the dynamics? What performance do I have in mind? And then what constraints do I have with my hardware? Now, we haven't even gotten to modeling yet, but from these performance constraints, the transient constraints, you know where I'm going with this. You pick some target routes. We like to call this a Z grid. You know, from this, your settling time condition will make a donut in there. So if you have like a minimum and maximum settling time, you know your roots have to be within a donut of some inner and outer radius. With your overshoot, your roots have to lie within some kind of heart shape like this. And with rise time, let's make another region. If you have an upper and lower bound, you might have to like go within this kind of region. And what you're looking for is where things overlap. And this is where you can pick your discrete time roots. Acceptable region is where constraints overlap. It's like a Venn diagram. From this acceptable region, you're going to pick your target roots. So this is work you can do in advance when you're designing a digital control system. Before you even have a model for your system. Okay, let's talk about getting a model though. Because you need a model that relates the dynamics of the input to the output. Let's come down this way. Model. Now, the way I see it, there are two approaches. Let's take the left path first. This is using physics. Project 2, part 1, with the self-balancing robot, uses this approach. When you use Newton's laws, whatever, to get a model for a system, what you end up with is a continuous time differential equation. Oh, don't do this on me, Pin. And it'll look something like, I don't know, it could be a certain order. Let's just say it's like theta double dot equals blah, blah, blah. Let's take another path. This path is called system identification. And what this gives you, most system identification algorithms, right out of the gate, they're going to give you a discrete time state space model. That's right. So a discrete time state space model, it's going to look like this. You're going to have your output equation. So my output, let's say the angular velocity of the motor, is going to be a C matrix times your state vector plus a D matrix times U. And most of the time this is zero, so we can just leave it out. And this is your corresponding state equation. You should just think of discrete time state space as a difference equation, but it's put in a matrix form, a first order matrix form. Now, once you have this model and you have your target poles, you have your constraints, etc., we can go from here to do state feedback control, but I don't want to do that right now. State feedback control, but first we're going to go to the other side. Our flowchart is developing. Okay. Let's say I don't want to do state feedback. I want to do root locus control. All right, here's what you got to do. Well, we'll make a couple paths, okay? But let's say you had a continuous time model and I want to do root locus control. What I would do, convert this to a continuous time state space model. So this is also what you're doing, part one, project two. And this is going to give you an equation like this. Y of t is C times X of t. I'm going to leave out the D matrix. X dot of t is A continuous X of t plus B continuous U of t. And what you're going to do with this, once you have the state space model, now you convert this into a discrete time state space model. So there's a couple equations that help you out with that conversion, like the corresponding discrete time A matrix is the matrix exponential of the continuous A matrix you found times your sampling period. And this sampling period is whatever you chose at the beginning based on the constraints of your microcontroller. And B is going to be A minus an identity matrix times the inverse of the continuous A matrix times the continuous time B matrix. So it's kind of interesting. If you are able to use system identification on your real life system, boom, it goes directly to a discrete time state space model. Whereas if you model something with physics, you have a couple intermediate steps to convert you back to discrete time. Sometimes you just, you can't do system ID. I mean, you might look at this and be like, oh, system ID is always preferred, but sometimes it's hard to get the measurements that you need. You might not be able to do it. Okay, so let's say I want to do root locus control. Well, you're going to start with this discrete time state space model, whether you got it from system ID or you got it from a continuous thing. So we want to do, our goal is to do root locus design. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to convert that discrete time state space model into a discrete time transfer function. So the transfer function will be the Z transform of your output over the Z transform of your input. And we'll call that ratio G of Z. And it's nice because there's a formula that gives you this transfer function directly from your state space model. So it's this, it's C times ZI minus A minus one. So the inverse of that times B. How is system ID usually done? Like what measurements are needed? Step frequency response data? Yeah, you can do a step response. You can do frequency response. So if you're taking MAE 334 right now, labs 3 and 4 show you how to get the frequency response. Actually, that's a little different because those system identification techniques give you a transfer function in the S domain, which is a continuous time model. So that kind of system ID you'd still have to do some conversions to get the discrete time. But I think it's more common to use something called the eigensystem realization algorithm. Let me write that out for you. This was developed at NASA back in the day. Eigensystem realization algorithm. And they originally used it to get a model for the structural vibration of satellites and like satellite panels and stuff. So they were doing it to get models for flexible structures so that when you have a model for that, you can design controllers that limit the vibrations. Pretty cool. So I think a system ID algorithm like this is more popular. It's a little more automated. If you're interested in this and you're staying with us for graduate school, right now Dr. Singh is teaching a whole class on system ID. And I'm pretty sure the eigensystem realization algorithm is part of that. But that one definitely just gives you right away, A, B, C, D, here you go, have a nice day. But it measures the input data, measures the output data, and then makes a black box model to fit that data. It's kind of like curve fitting, but curve fitting with difference equations. Okay. So yeah, we want to do root locus. Well, what you need to do is you need to get g of z, your transfer function for your plant. And then you're going to set up, well, this is the type of feedback loop we looked at. You take your plant, but we're going to have a controller send the input command to the plant. Jonathan says, do continuous time differential equation models account for different system modes that could occur with different inputs? How do we simulate, understand different mode responses? You can analyze the modes of systems in continuous or discrete time. The basic idea of modal analysis is you try to transform the system into an independent set of coordinates. Like that's what a mode is. A mode is like, I'm trying not to use jargon here. I'm trying to like, it's like the independent set of dynamics that each of them don't affect the other one. So like a mode, you can excite the a mode of a system by itself. Like maybe the first mode of a beam, which is, maybe I can draw a picture over here. Like if you have a flexible beam, cantilever, its first mode looks like this. Like it can either flex up, flex down, and it'll like oscillate back and forth between those. So you can excite this kind of motion all by itself. The second mode so we'll start with the same beam. But it has, I'm probably going to screw this up. No, I got it. It looks like this. And it has what we call a node here. And that point will stay stationary as this beam vibrates. Actually, we did this in 334, yeah. So this will look just like this. And the beam will go back and forth. So they call these modes because this motion has no part of this motion and vice versa. Everything that this beam does can be a combination of these two modes, but these two are independent of each other. So a mode is like the most fundamental dynamic way of looking at a system. It breaks it down into its most basic component that can't be separated any further. So the way we like find these modes with modeling is you convert a system into modal coordinates. So it's a mathematical problem where you try to find a representation of the system dynamics where each state does not depend on the other state. So there's something called like a modal transformation, which tries to do that. And that's like how we, it's cool. Like these modes like exist in real life, but you might find them on a computer doing modal decomposition before you actually see it in real life. I don't know if that makes any sense, but it's very interesting. And it extends to other abstract concepts. I think I might have mentioned this before earlier, like you can decompose a person's face in terms of modes. Or you could like, you know, have an abstract idea of like, what is the human face and what are the modes of a face? And that's how they do facial recognition. They don't characterize, they characterize your face based on like some abstract modes and No. I'm not talking about a death metal song. I'm talking about mathematical decomposition. You could probably decompose a conversation into its modes. You know, somebody might tell you something and they're using way too many words and you're like, get to the point. That's basically trying to dissect the modes of their sentence. Like they might just be saying one thing, but it's muddled together with a bunch of other stuff. Okay. Okay, so you have your plant, and we're gonna make a feedback loop. So you have some measurement of the plant. You have your reference signal, your error signal, your control signal, your output. And remember, at the very beginning, we already have our target closed loop dynamics in mind based on our performance constraints. So in the back of my mind, when I build this loop, I'm thinking all of this behaves with dynamics like Z star. So the way that we make sure that that happens is we have two criteria. We have the angle criterion, which is if you take your plant and you multiply it with your controller transfer function and you evaluate those at Z star, it better come out to pi. Plus or minus pi, whatever. And then there's an additional criterion. If you take the product of G and D, in other words, if you take the open loop transfer function, if you evaluate that at Z star, take the magnitude, it better be 1. And this guarantees that your closed loop poles exist at Z star. And what you get out of this, you get a controller that looks like this. It's going to have a gain out in front. It's going to have some zeros. There's no limit to how many you can put. You have some poles. And so this part, like the zeros and the poles, you use the angle criterion to determine those. Oh, and then remember, some of these poles might be determined by steady state conditions. Like for example, if you want zero steady state error for a step reference, you know your system has to be type 1. So your open loop transfer function has to have a pole at Z equals 1. So your controller might have to contribute that pole. Okay, and then this gain, you use the magnitude criterion to figure out what this is. And then if you satisfy the angle criterion, you satisfy the magnitude criterion, you're in the home stretch, because that means your closed loop poles will include the target poles. But you might also have some additional poles you have to watch out for. We'll just call them velociraptor poles. They're rogue poles that we didn't account for, but we have to monitor them. And so basically, what you might do is you have to iterate on this process until all of your closed loop poles are where you want them to be. So let's say closed loop poles, good. Let's say your answer is yes. Then you're ready to put this on a microcontroller because I know D of Z is a transfer function that relates my control input to my error signal. And if you use backward shifting theorem, I can get a line of code that says my control at step K is, I don't know, some parameter times my control from before plus blah, blah, blah. I don't know, plus another parameter times my error from before. My pin. So you can put it in a difference equation form. And then you're done. So that's what Project One was all about. It's just that simple. I guess it's not really that simple. But it gets easier the more you do it. For some of you, it might feel simple at this point. It still might feel crazy. That's okay. It takes time and practice. So let's say, okay, I don't want to do root locus control. I have this nice state space model. Why don't we just use that? Let's do state feedback control. Well, I think from once you get used to it, state feedback control is procedurally a little more straightforward. So there's two types of state feedback controllers you can make. At least two. Let's define two of them. You can make a regulator, and that just helps hold the system stationary. At zero, like however you define all of your parameters to be zero, it'll hold the system there. It could be you could define zero to be running a motor at a fixed speed, and you could design a regulator that's like, okay, I'm just gonna keep it at that speed. Like that's what I consider my zero. And if something from the outside tries to disrupt it, the regulator tries to take it back. So there's a regulator, but more generically, you can have a tracker. So this is if you want to track some time-varying reference signal. So, this is how you define your controller for a regulator. You have U at step K is equal to a state feedback matrix K times. I'll write it this way because it'll make sense in a second. zero vector, so it's just zero, minus my estimated states at step k. So I want to compare this to for a tracker. Well, there's two types we looked at. One is called a feed forward tracker. This is not the preferred way to do it, but this is what it looks like. U K is a state feedback matrix times, now it's not a zero vector, it's some reference states, minus your estimated states, plus a steady state term, which is some number times your reference signal. So it kind of like adds on some extra juice that you need to bring the steady state error to zero. But if you have like some modeling errors, it's hard to know exactly what this number should be in real life. So it's not super reliable. That's why we prefer this alternative formulation of the tracker with integral control. So in this case, U is equal to K, but I'm going to call it an augmented K. And now it's going to be my reference states with a zero tacked on at the bottom, minus my original state estimates, but now I'm going to put my integral state tacked on at the bottom. So this is why we call it augmented, because we augmented the original state vector to include an integral state. And that's it. There's no extra additional term tacked on at the end. It's just this. Now we talked about this. Sometimes you can estimate this integral state. Other times we don't estimate it. Because that integral state is equal to this. And it always looks like this. Plus your error at k minus 1. So it's not too complicated an expression. And this error, once again, is your reference at k minus 1 minus your measurement at k minus 1. So you don't necessarily have to estimate this. You could just use this equation and throw the result in there. Okay, but the work you need to do, and we just let MATLAB do this, we have to figure out these K matrices. And when you do your state estimates, you also have to get an L matrix. Well, let's show how we get those. And then that'll be it. So if you want your feedback gain matrix K, we use the Ackermann formula, but I would just go into MATLAB, use the Acker command. And it's as simple as that. You put in your A and B matrix, and you put in your target poles, and this gives it right back. Or if you're doing integral control and you want that augmented one, well, you're gonna have an augmented A matrix, an augmented B matrix, and you're also gonna augment your Because you have to add one more target pole because you added one more state. And this is cool because you don't have some rogue state that you have to watch out for. With this technique, you define exactly what that additional state is. So you don't really have to iterate. Like in real life, you'll always have to iterate because things won't behave like you expect. But at least in the simulation phase, you don't have to iterate this. You define exactly what that pole is. Okay, the estimator has an equation that looks like this. So my estimated states at K are gonna, I'll take my A matrix times my state at K minus one, B matrix using my input from K minus one. And for this input, whatever type of state feedback controller you're using, you use the definition from above. Like if I'm using a regulator, if I'm doing a tracker, if I'm doing a feed forward tracker, whatever you're using for your control input, you just got to plug it in there. And then the last piece is you put this plus L times your measured output, and you get the difference between your, oh, this should be K minus one, your estimated output. How do you get this L matrix? Well, the good news, you can also use the acker command for this, but you have to do A transpose, C transpose, and then you're going to have what I call beta star, which are your estimator poles. They're different than Z star. They should be faster. You know, something like 2 to 6 times faster. So like 2 to 6 times faster than Z star. And you have to, whatever that gives you back, you have to take the transpose of that as well. Whew! And that's state feedback control. I think like procedurally, there's less steps. A computer does more of the work. Everything's got its own drawbacks. But guys, this is what we have done this semester. Oops. Can you believe it? That's our flowchart. Still feels like a blur. Where do we go in our educational journey from here? If you are hungry for more controls, and I gotta run in like a minute because we're doing the 3:34 lecture. So if you have more questions for me, definitely reach out because I want to answer your questions. But you should look into optimal control. You should look into nonlinear control. You should look into state estimation with Kalman filters. You should, actually, I think this is the best thing you can do. You should look up some Arduino project. Whether it's like you make your own little robot, you do your own UAV flight controller. the best way to learn this is to apply it. And you'll find, as you try to do a real life problem, that you'll need the extra theory. Like, you'll need Kalman filters, you'll need maybe a nonlinear controller. So those aren't just made as mathematical curiosities. Those were actually needed to solve real life problems. So I say, start with a simple real life problem. Maybe buy just like a DC motor like we used, but try to do it on your own. I can send you my sample code and then incrementally build from there. Guys, I wish I could hang out with you for another hour. I got to run, set up for another class. I'm going to be back this afternoon. I'm going to be back next week. Please come and hang out. Thank you, guys. So happy to have you guys as students. Super privileged, super honored. You guys are fantastic. I can't sing your praises enough. Blessings on you guys.